have to get one point really clear before we go too far. I need to know who wants to know what the future of the Corvette is by show of hands. Okay, well, you're all going to be disappointed. If you still want to flip the safety off and push the button, you can talk to Harlan Charles right away. So anyway, I say that with a little bit of fun. But what I am here today to talk about is a little bit about what's going on inside the plant. And so, you know, we've had no less than three really large announcements about investment that is going on inside the plant. And if you've been anywhere near the area, you've seen the huge paint facility. And so the idea today is not just the paint facility, but we also have investment that's going on inside the plant, where we do our general assembly, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm here to talk a little bit about, you know, what we're doing during the break that we're going to take starting in August. So many of you may have heard that we are going to close the plant for 13 weeks. That's the plan. And this is to do a number of things. And by the time I get done with the presentation, hopefully you'll have a little bit better insight into not only what we're doing, but some of the motivations behind it. So as we go through, anybody that has a question, feel free to answer or to ask or answer if you have any. And maybe you can just talk to yourself if that's the case. But make this a two-way conversation. That'll be fun. And I do have at the end, close to the end, I've got some videos of the paint shop where we have some robots that are actually doing some painting. So we'll be able to talk a little bit about that as we go through. So what are we doing? And because I don't have a little teleprompter here, excuse me while I turn around, this 13-week downtime that we're taking this summer, starting at the end of July. So the last day of July, it starts the 13-week downtime, and then basically we're going to come back in the November time period. And when we come back, we're going to have what we refer to as GA, or General Assembly. We will have taken the whole General Assembly process that we know right now, and we will have completely reconfigured. And like I said, we will talk a little bit about what we're doing and why. And as the individuals that love the car, what does this mean for all of you? Okay, and then the last thing that I like to put in here, these things that we're doing will have a big impact into, you know, product quality. That's one of our goals. And also, we're very mindful of the people that are working in the facility. You know, these industrial athletes, I like to refer to them as, doing things that can make the job easier will have also a very positive impact on our product. So, all right. You know, when you're standing right where I am, it's like you're that kid that came to the movie theater last and you're in that front row. So, precision never rests. This is what we have on the front of the plant, and I think it typifies what our goal is with the Corvette brand and the Corvette product that we have. And then I put in here, we're trying to advance the legacy of the Corvette. The fact of the matter is that when the C7 came out, for a number of reasons, the primary investment was put into the body shop. We put some work into general assembly, but the way that you can assemble a car, there's a lot of different variations. Certainly there's things that have to happen before others, but how all of these things interact is, you know, as the evolution of the C4, C5, C6, and the C7, you can take many different approaches. You can have a minimum investment just to get the product out there. And so what we're required to do is to do a new body structure and then make the investment so we could make the car. And we're going to take the time now, and you will see that we're going to do a lot more optimization of how the car goes together. So this is what I like to talk about, the enterprise approach. So any one subsystem in the plant, you're putting a door together, and you guys have all seen this if you've been in the plant tours, door line is one of the first places that you walk by. Door line, engine dress line, all of these little subsystems, they're inside the factory in different locations. And where they are has a lot to do with, you know, with all the sequencing of the assembly of the car. And there are better ways than others. And again, this is one of the messages that I want to talk about. So the second one is, you know, the long-term sustainability of the plant. It's fundamental to the success of any organization. So, you know, we need to reinvest. We have had an unbelievable run on the C7. We're moving into the fifth year of production. We have already made 2018 model year cars, our pre-production or manufacturing validation cars. And some of them are out here. The majority of the program team that are here are driving them. I'm driving one. Harlan's driving one. You notice how I pull Harlan into the conversation?
Yeah.
As a distraction. Just don't forget that he is over there also. But even after right next to the fifth year of this car, we still have a lot of people that are very interested in buying the car. It is still a very, very relevant car. So to maintain that, we need to stay sharp, you know, so we also need to take advantage of technical advancements, stay ahead of our competition. So the idea that precision never rests, I think, is very true. And then this last point that I put here, when you add up and these are the announced numbers that we've had. For anybody who's done large projects in their careers or they've been around them, we know that sometimes what we plan to spend can move not many times down, but sometimes they go up. And we're probably closer to $850 million in what we think it's going to take. So I like to use the nice round number of close to $1 billion. I mean, it's just better when you have that extra zero on the end. And what I mean by that is that it's very significant. So it's keeps us all busy. So here's an example, and this is where you get to see a little video. It's a little bit jumpy, but you can watch this instead of looking at me, which is my fault. But the idea here, and the first word that I put in this text, is that we're relocating. We have a large map of what's going on in the factory as it relates to the layout, and I have that, and I will show it to you. It's one of the last slides. But when you realize that you want to, you know, reorganize how the car goes together, and you look at what we have here, this before picture, which actually there's the same young lady at the end of the line. This is an engine that's hanging on an overhead hoist that is relatively inflexible. So when you want to do something different with this, and as we look at the systems that we have in General Motors, where, you know, we do work that looks more like this in a lot of our operations, you can start to see the advantage of the change. And when you realize that you have to pick an operation up and move it to a different part of the plant, you certainly would take that opportunity, instead of just relocating what you have, you would take the opportunity to upgrade. And this is what we've done. This is one that we actually started in the December timeframe. So we had the real estate to relocate the engine line. And if you walk in the facility like I do every morning, kind of in the front of the facility, you walk right out into the plant and you see this. It's right out kind of in front of the main office. And this is what we have. You'll see that we have kitting, so this orange or yellow rack. You'll see, excuse me, the catalyst and the exhaust system. They're all the parts that the operators are going to need are right there next to the work that they're doing. So it's easier for them. All these parts are prepared and they're put right next to the product. So these are some of the advantages. And what I've written here, you know, is we have a lot of improvement in this material presentation. Again, that's these racks that are on the left-hand side. And it's very flexible. And this last one, this engine, while you can't see it in the video, you can take this engine and rotate it 360 degrees. So, you know, if you're putting a flex plate on the back of the engine, you can have that work directly in front of you. If you're putting an exhaust manifold on, you can have that work directly in front of you. So it's just a better solution. And it's one that's very similar that we use in our other assembly plants, adapted to what we use here. The next one, both the cockpit and the door sub-assemblies. So this isn't when we're putting the cockpit in, or this isn't when we're, you know, putting the door on the car. This is when we're taking the door and we are simply installing the glass, installing, you know, the speakers, installing hinges, installing trim pieces, etc., etc. What we have and what you see in the picture behind me, this is the existing line. You've probably, again, if you've been in the plant, you've walked by this. What do you see here? You see an overhead conveyor that has a lot of steel, a huge infrastructure, and once again, the first word that I wrote in here is that it's going to be relocated. So we're picking it up and we're moving it somewhere else. Now this is the same play, so after this third or fourth slide, you're going to get with the program and you're going to say, okay, so you're moving it and you're going to upgrade it. It's like, that's exactly what I'm going to keep showing you, is that we're going to do this upgrade. And this little thing over here on the right-hand side, Arlington is our assembly plant in Texas. They make trucks. And this is, these are pictures, somebody from Texas here?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, woo! Right? Don't mess with Texas. I'll actually be there next month, so I'm not going to do anything wrong before I do. But this is a little AGV or AGC, automated guided vehicle or automated guided cart. And you'll see the tape that's on the ground, these white lines. The little machine just follows its way around. This is the way that we deliver our cockpits to the body shop, or to what we call our composite line, and they just drive themselves. If you're going to install a new system, what do you want? Do you want a whole bunch of steel in the air that's super hard to reconfigure in any way, shape, or form, or do you want that, where when you come up with a better way to move your material around, you peel the tape up, you reposition it, probably new tape, and then you run, right? So they're all battery powered, so it's a hybrid. I never even thought about this. We're using hybrid technology in the Corvette. By the way, that gets to the point. If you get to know me, I do like to joke around a little bit. I'm used to work, but I also like to have fun. I was at the Orion assembly plant where the new Chevy Bolt is produced. Has anybody heard about that? It's a really, it's kind of off the hook product, 240 miles on one charge. And when I was there reviewing some different things, I told the team that, oh yeah, you know, we have a battery in the Corvette too that's a little bit similar to what we have. And I thought, really, you know, what are you guys going to get an electrified version of the Corvette? And they said, what kind of battery do you have? And I said, one, to start a huge engine, that's awesome. and you can keep your big battery that doesn't start anything cool to make noise. And I went back to Bowling Green and they said, please go. I haven't been back since. And that's okay, I'll stay in Bowling Green. So again, we have, and if you can see the center picture, there's a little orange cone there, that's just so people can see it coming a little bit. And there's safety stuff in the front, on the nose of it. I don't know if there's a little laser here or not. Yeah, right there. That's a sensor. It can't run into anything, so it's smart. And then up here, this is a kit. So this is, just like in that previous slide, the door with all the parts is moving along, and all the parts have been provided for the operator. So we make it better for the operator, which makes it better for the operations. So then there's just another picture of what we have. So this isn't installed right now, but we're going to start in about a month. We're going to, in a location that we have that's been freed up, we're going to start installing the new door line. We'll continue to utilize the existing door line. Then when we come back from the break, we will have torn all of this out and we'll be using the new version. Okay, panel installation. So this picture that you see is just rear fascias. It's just a pretty picture. I didn't know what to put here, so would it be cool to see some different colors. But again, the first word that we have, we're relocating and revamping the panel installation process. Obviously, if you have an idea of how the facility is laid out, if you're at the front of the plant, where my office is, and you face the plant, so you face north, to the very east is the paint shop. Now, the old paint shop, what we refer to sometimes as the Queen Mary. This is the paint shop manager, Chuck Valentini, he lovingly refers to it as the Queen Mary. The new paint shop is directly north of the facility. So these are, it's just a huge geometry problem. So as we're doing everything that I've already described, now we're making panels and they're in the wrong place. These things, these panels, as everybody here can attest, you know, they can be damaged. So we don't like to move them around. We want them to come into the process and be very, very protected. And what we have right now here is we have in our current operation no less than 9 points on our assembly process where we install these panels. And I'm going to show you the layout that I have as to where we do that. And again, if you've been to the plant, you'll walk by, and if you were made aware of this, you would say, oh yeah, you know, Kai's right. It's like, well, yeah, I am. We put panels on almost right when the car comes down out of the sky, and we start our trim operations. And the car runs around through the whole factory with these final finished painted surfaces. Now, let's just have a different idea. What if we put the panels on almost the last thing before the car left the plant? Would that be better? The answer is yes, for damage, and the other one is for fit. So for fit, for gap fit, the relationship of a front fender to the hood, to the fascia, all of these things. If you can imagine, if we were all a chain of people working and I was doing some work and then somebody else and then somebody else and somebody else and over in another room, the chances of having communication to refine the process and understand what's going on just gets to be much, much, much more difficult. Putting that all together and later in the process is just inherently better, and that's what we're going to do. So, with that, this is an interesting chart. It says a lot. The first thing that you'll notice is superimposed into the back of this is the existing plant layout for our factory. When you guys come into the plant for a plant tour, you come in up here, and then you start walking around, and it's actually the aisleways back actually behind these pictures. You come back down around and you walk through the plant. The point is that you could follow this conveyor and see this first point, that's where we do work. This next point, we put this on. This point, and as the car moves through the process and meanders down and around and back, etc., we end up putting all of these different panels on. And when you take this enterprise approach or a holistic approach to what we're doing, not just in relationship to the engine line, the door line, the you name it, all of the other systems, and then you look at this, you can really realize and have a better understanding of why we want to change things in the Bowling Green assembly plant, and that's what we're going to do. So all of these little red dots or circles are coming up into this area, and this is where in the kind of the northwest corner of our general assembly operation in the future, this is not the new layout, it's the old layout to demonstrate our current situation. We're going to do all that work in a very short geographic line or a short geographic area, small geographic area. This is also very close to where the panels are going to come in from the new paint shop, because the paint shop is, you know, it's like off the chart, it's over here. And all the panels, when you guys go on a plant tour, you walk out and you see a lot of these panels, the fascias specifically, that are in the process. You'll see all of these, and then they have to be delivered to different parts of the operation. Now, by getting everything up here, the paint shop is way up there, you know, half a mile away, almost. We wouldn't want to have to take all those panels and cross all of the spaghetti web of conveyors that we have in the plant. So this is another reason why we're reorganizing everything in the facility. Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Nice job.
Good. All right, so this is where everybody again starts watching the video and they don't listen to me. So you guys can pay attention to the video. And then meanwhile, I'll read what I wrote here. This is speeded up. Mm-hmm. So this is actual footage that was taken maybe a week ago of a what we call a scuck. This is what is the giant rack that's holding the panels up. In almost every case, very, very close to in-car position. And when I say that, I mean the door is as it would be positioned on the car. The hood is as it would be positioned on the car. The halo and the rear hatch, and et cetera, et cetera. And again, while it's speeded up a little bit, you can see that we have a, it's very, very large. You can see the scale. This scuck, or as I refer to it as scuckzilla, Scuckzilla is bigger than any other painting fixture, painting scuck that we have in any other part of the company, including Arlington Assembly or our full-size truck or SUV plants. And the reason for that is that you can see here, see where the robots are? They're trying to go in the door jams, they're going around, they have to come up and they have to go under. In a normal body shop, or in a normal paint shop, you would have the cars would have the hoods on, they would have the doors on, and they would simply robotically open the door, spray paint or jam, maybe you would call that, those areas, robotically you would close the door, and then you would do the outside, you would leave the door open just a little bit. Same with the rear trunk lid and the other movable parts. This makes the scuck really more like a carrier, and it's just simply moving the body. What we have to do with the Corvette is we have to explode the panels off of the car, because you can't move things here, you can't pick things up. You can see that we have to go around because we don't want to upset the panels. This is similar to what we do in our current shop, but again, we have evolved over a lot of time in our current facility, and we haven't had the ability to just say, what do you want to do when you're painting a Corvette panel, which are very difficult to start with because of the materials? How do you do it better? And this, you can see, is a very good example of that. Okay, so testing. So where are we on our schedule for the paint shop? I mentioned that we took this video just a week or so ago. We're making, we're in the process of doing the development for both white and yellow. And you would ask the question, why would you start with white? Anybody have an idea? It's one of the most popular colors. And then here's the trick, why would yellow be second?
White's the base.
Lieutenant Clearcoat.
White's the base.
The color.
Kind of
white is the base.
Okay, so if anybody got this right, raise their hand. The reason that we're going to do yellow second is because it's the only other color that uses a white prime coat. So we have one brownie point up here. And unfortunately, since I told him this about an hour ago, I have one other person, so that's good. And then what we will do is we will continue to move forward, and we will then take the other popular colors, you know, red, black, white, et cetera, and we will get this started up in the new shop. Our goal, by the time we're done with the 13-week shutdown, is that we would have enough time, because we're going to be working full-time in the new paint shop, that we'll have at least half of the colors ready to go in the new paint shop. It gets to be, and I take a deep breath, because it gets to be extremely complex in the plant. And I've found a way to maybe communicate why it's going to be so complex. Usually you don't have a project like this go into production in the middle of the vehicle production. You would do all of the paint development prior to starting up a new car. We don't have that luxury of making the car already. And to take enough time to develop every color so we could completely shut down the old shop is just unrealistic. So we're going to have a period of time where we're going to overlap manufacturing in both the new and the old paint shop, and we're going to try to compress it as much as we possibly can. But that's what we're gonna have to go do.
Hey, Kyle,
I liken it.
You paint the panels in car position?
We paint the panels just as you see here, and the only exception of the in-car position is a slight angle change. For example, the rear hatch. The rear hatch might have an attitude like this, and we just put it flat. You can see it. It's right there.
Yep.
So we just make it flat because it's closed. And if you ask the question, why would you do that? The flat surfaces or the horizontal surfaces, when you paint, are always going to be better. So you would say, well, why wouldn't you take that door and lay it on its side? And then the answer would be, well, why don't you lay on the ground and look at your door? I don't know why that just jumped into my mind. I guess it worked. The fact of the matter is that when you walk up to your car and you're ready to open the door, you see that horizontal surface right there. We want that to be really good. If you're going to pick one or the other, you're going to make that really good. And underneath, down by the rocker panel, which is going to be at the bottom of the door, you can see the door is pushed out a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. So there's a small adjustment where we don't compromise that A surface, that top horizontal surface that every owner is going to be looking at. And we pull that out so we don't have to defy physics and try to spray uphill to get the bottom part of the door. Does that make sense?
Thank you.
Okay, very good. I'm not a paint expert, but I stayed at a Holiday Inn Express last night. And I try. I'm learning. It's very, very interesting. Okay, and so this next point, we have the current paint shop. We have plans into 2018. We will be working like crazy to get everything switched over as quickly as possible. And then what I had written here, the last one. Yeah, we are going to start with Arctic White. And then we're going to move through with yellow and then a number of the other larger
black rose.
Okay, next one here. A couple things about the paint shop. So everybody asks about what are you doing in the paint shop that's going to make the car appearance better. And it's very complex. And I've tried to break it down into something that's bite-sized. And by the way, on the upper right corner here, those are the official first panels that we made. And actually, before I go through, I mean, you guys can read that. I can talk to the pictures and show you a few other things. That's the Skuckzilla. The hood's not on. That would be up on top above the door rings. But you can see how large this thing is and how this thing has simply exploded. And then you can see down at the bottom this oven. This is an oven that would take that carrier, and this thing would ride through that oven to cure the paint. A couple other observations, and as you read through the four bullet points, one of them is that the new paint shop, it will really, maybe not from a medical standpoint, but from a very much a practical standpoint, it will be considered a clean room. The floor that you see here, that's what you would expect to see in our new paint shop at all times. And you can see it is just very clean. We are in the process of physically wiping down every surface from the top of the plant to the bottom. Not just what's convenient, not just, 6 feet and down. It's about 20 different particle count, online particle counters that are always sampling air and measuring the particles. Somebody opens a door and in rushes air, we will know that and we will be able to countermeasure that. So it's going to be a clean room. And really, when you think about the paint shop as a building, the whole building, when you enter the paint shop proper, it is this clean room. But then you have a whole nother series of buildings or structures where the paint, these scuffs, Skuckzilla and his various parts, they never see even that environment. They're behind lightweight plastic walls and enclosures, enough where you can easily see what's going on, but never will a draft impact any type of debris that could move around in the facility. Doors will open and close and create air gaps. It's truly world class. So this is one of the things that will have a serious improvement in things that we don't want in the paint getting into the paint. The first one on the list, this cutting edge robotics, robots with electrostatic bell applicators for improved fluid flow. That says a lot, but if you would remember looking back at that video, what's on the end of the robot is what we call a bell. And in this little bell, there's a little device that's spinning extremely fast, thousands of RPMs. And this is what we use to atomize the paint. This is not go to Home Depot, you know, walk into the paint section and grab a $79, you know, high volume, low velocity, I'm gonna do a great good paint job. No, this is really, really high tech. And the idea is to make the paint particles as small as physically possible by really understanding the physics, so you can have small, small, small particles going onto the painting surfaces. So that's what that means. And then the other thing that does for us is it gives us the ability, in many cases, to the second bullet, this multi-step. And so as you would understand this, it's really not we're going to put two coats of paint on the car. What we're going to do, because we have designed in the capacity and the time for the robots to, if you can imagine, the same paint path, instead of putting 100% paint on like we were forced to do in the existing paint shop in one shot, here's what we would do. We're going to do the first one, we're going to put 70% of the paint on. Then we're going to quickly come back and we're going to put 50% more paint on, netting out 120%, and these are just generic ways to understand that. It's maybe a little bit more paint applied slower, more precisely, with better application processes, and it will yield flatter paint. It's always the case when you apply paint, it's better to do thin coats and more of them. But it's also balanced. You don't want too much paint or that just causes other problems. So now we have the tools, we have the knobs that we'll be able to turn to optimize. And then the last one, this is also complex, because it is not the case that we will have any of the paint that we currently use in our existing facility. We're not just gonna take Arctic White in our old shop and take a big tank of it over and drop it into the new shop. That doesn't work, because we want to continue to decrease the temperature at which we cure the paint. And this goes to the substrate. The substrate is, you know, it's a SLC or fiberglass, and we have carbon fiber, et cetera, et cetera. These things don't like to be hot when there is liquid paint on them. So as an easy way to understand this, if we put a liquid paint on top of the panel, we put it into an oven that's 260 degrees, which is roughly the temperature of our ovens in our current shop. It's above boiling point for water, and if we can heat that SMC or the fiberglass substrate up enough, and the fiberglass has maybe some solvents from the paint that got absorbed into that panel, when you get it that hot, what happens when you have a solid that turns into a liquid because of heat that then turns into a gas? Liquid to gas is a big expansion, and that, bloop, it comes right through the paint. If you can reduce the temperature, you reduce that effect. It's physics, and this is what we're gonna try to do, which means all the paint needs to be reformulated, and it also means that, it doesn't mean that we need less energy to dry the paint. We need the same amount of energy, so it's lower temperature, but the ovens are gonna have to be longer because they're gonna have to be in the ovens for a longer period of time. So this is what you see in the lower right-hand corner. This is an oven, and you can see all the little nozzles in there that we will have to go in and make all the adjustments to make sure the air is going exactly where we want it and where we want temperature. We get temperature and where we want air movement, we get air movement, and then it'll have to go through this oven and And that's the kind of a very simplistic version of the chemistry that we're going to be using in this new shop. We should be the lowest temperature cured paint shop that we know of for mass production. Okay. What about questions?
I'm going to grab a drink of water here, and I can drop my clicker, so I don't need to use that anymore.
Yeah?
You're talking about shooting solar oil. Where do you go through the ovens and then shoot clear, or do you shoot clear right after the powder?
So the question is, how do you apply the paint? And we have to put the primer on first, and then once the primer is applied, we go through. It's not really a curing oven; it's like a heated flash. So we just get it enough to kind of get a skin, and then we apply the base coat. We go through another heated flash zone, then we apply the clear coat, and then you go into the oven. Having more ovens that would completely cure the part in between the various steps adds a lot of energy. So we energy consumption and oven requirements. So this is one of the strategies, is to try to only have this one curing operation, and we do it at the last part. Make sense? Okay. What else? Paint shop or anything else other than the products? Okay. Yeah. So Glenn says, speak up. It took him a lot more words to say than me. That's because I work in manufacturing. It's like, get up, speak up, let's go. What do we have right here?
We're going to have two paint shops operating for some months. You're going to have the new paint shop that's delivering directly to your new assembly area. You've still got the old paint shop. How do you get those parts?
Good question.
You took your monorail out.
Okay, so the question, I'll repeat it. You have the new paint shop having panels coming in from the north. You get the existing panel paint shop with panels coming in from the east. And we are building a platform that will service the existing paint shop and then give us the ability to have panels coming from the existing paint shop so that they cannot intermix. We won't have panels from the old shop mixed on a car with panels from the old shop. Did I say old shop twice?
Yeah. Yeah.
New and old. Okay, so you can't do that. In effect, we're going to have 20 colors of cars. We have 10, but it's going to be 10, and they're going to be distinctly separate. We need to keep them, from a process standpoint, separate. But we have to endure the complexity of making sure that we have to bring them together. They will go on the car at the same place, but we need to keep them separated. So, yes, we will, in our planning, we'll have the facilities to still take panels from the existing shop, and then bring them to the car in a new location.
Okay. The type of heat you're using for the paint ovens, electric, natural gas, how do you get the heat?
The heat is, I believe, you might have me stumped here. You want me to guess, or do you want me to say I don't know?
No. You can say you don't know, it's okay.
I believe it's electric. Because you don't want combustion byproducts, and this is just, I believe that it's electric. And I say this because we had I'm responsible for the budget of the plant, right? It's a big responsibility. We have a lot of people. And let's just say that I get a lot of outside assistance if I miss a detail or two. They're not afraid to tell me either, by the way. We're spending, in our early development of the new paint shop, we have metering for all utilities going in, $10,000 a day just for electrical. And so this is what I believe. But then that electrical energy is also used for chillers that we're using to condition the facility. So it's not just generating heat. It's like a giant, thermal thing. We're putting heat here and we're taking it out and we're managing humidity, et cetera, et cetera.
I like that. That works well. But you're forcing hot air into the oven. So there's an airflow in the oven.
It's a convection oven.
Okay.
So in that picture that you can't see anymore, there's like nozzles that are maybe 6 inches in diameter every few feet,
sure.
And there's a plenum behind that, and then the air goes through those nozzles, and we can adjust those, and then we can put the air where we want. We do all kinds of studies right. with the logging data,
right.
where is the temperature, where is the yeah. airflow. Yeah, good
thank
question.
You.
Okay, he gets the credit for stumping me. Yeah, what do we have one here?
With all the reorganization in the plant, will it require a lot of retraining?
Okay, so the question is, what about retraining? You're talking about the production operators?
Correct.
This is a huge issue because the ramp expectation for the company is, and this is another battle that I've had to endure over the course of the last months. People in the plant look at the car as a revenue generator. So let's just be very clear about that. Their expectation is, you're making cars, you do 170 a day. Take all the time you want for your 13-week downtime, come back, make 170 cars a day, and it's like, whoa, time out. Right? Nobody in the plant will have the same job when they left, because there's another key that I didn't omit intentionally, but because you asked the question. We're gonna change the rate of production from 17 an hour to 12. So all of our operators go from 3-minute cycles to 5-minute cycles. This is a almost, it's scientifically, it's like an exponential function of the difficulty in having an operator learn 3 to 5 minutes. It might be 4 or 5 times as difficult in this case. And so what we've done, we've partnered with a company called Vizendo, which is a Swedish company. And they, if you can imagine, first-person shooter games, right? So my boy, he's 14 years old, and he's got his headset on, and he's at his computer, and running around the block, and shooting at people. Imagine that, but put a car door in front of, on the screen, and you are the operator, and at the bottom of this console, you have the ability to, you have a number of different tools, and you have a number of different parts. And we will bring all the people back into the facility. We will utilize this technology to sit them down, because it has to be virtual, because the plant's going to be completely ripped up. And we will virtually train them in their job, which is the most difficult part, to get that muscle memory understood. And we will teach them. And it will go through multiple levels of certification, where as you go through, it gets harder and harder and harder. It won't give you any clues. And this is the method that we will use, not just for our operators doing assembly, but also other individuals that will be moving material around. Because again, what I didn't omit intentionally, when you look at the rearrangements, all of those kits that are on the door line, that are on the engine line, those are all made offline. When you walk through the plant, you see large totes with material in them. We don't like that. Those have to be delivered with fork trucks. We don't like fork trucks. Fork trucks are big. Fork trucks are heavy. Fork trucks move big things. Fork trucks run over, stuff. We want small things. We want tuggers. We will go from a ratio of almost 80% fork trucks to 15% fork trucks, which is huge. And there's a lot of advantages to that. So all those individuals, they left, and it's like, oh, there's my fork truck. I go get the stuff there, to bring it there, there. They're really busy. Now you walk in, it's like, not only do you not know where to bring the stuff, you don't get your fork truck. Get on the tugger. And so we have a big job. We need lots of help. And we've got it. Yeah, what do you got?
So does this amount to a complete gut job of the main assembly line?
So the question is, does it amount to a complete gut job, quote unquote, of the assembly line? The answer is yes. I jokingly, and I'm sometimes accused of making things very polarizing. We'll have maybe 10% of our conveyors that are used in general assembly stay. The rest is gone. The door line, I've showed you, gone. The engine line, it's already gone. We've already gutted that. Just about everything else is going to be gone, floor to ceiling. We will spend in 13 weeks over $1 million every day. Think about that. That's my new world. Hours per unit is the metric that we would use. Hours per unit, which is per car. Because we're making this re-rate and we're going from 17 to 12, In all actuality, it's not going to be a positive impact. It's not going to be a positive impact on productivity metric. It's going to have the impact what you guys saw. So a lot of this is going to be done for a quality standpoint, measured in, you know, what we call mutilations or an unintended damage to a panel because it was put on too early or other things. So I guess in a way to describe that, it's another small investment in, if you want to do it right, and not always is the fastest way. You didn't ask the question, but I'm going to add this in as a bonus because you look like you're cool. I could be wrong. A similar question was asked yesterday when we had the board of directors for the museum. I took them through the new paint shop, a little bit on the periphery, but nonetheless, we'll call it a paint shop tour. We're going to have more people in the paint shop, you know, per shift and per hours per unit per car, for the same reason. If you want to do it right, it might take a little bit more resource, in this case, human resources. Way in the back.
Your total production numbers, 2017 versus 18, will there be a big difference in production numbers?
You know, 17 is quirky. Let me repeat the question. So what are the volume projections for the 17? And you mean calendar year or model year? Calendar. So the calendar year, 2017, it's not right because and it's not really relative because you're going to have 13 weeks of downtime. We started building inventory last year.
Okay. No. Is there going to be a bigger variance with the late start in the 18 model year?
Well, the 18 model year, we're starting on June 5th. So we're starting it compared to last year. I thought it was done because Harlan wanted it this way. They did it on my birthday, which is July 11th. And then the year, I found out that it's June 5th. And I don't know whose birthday is on June 5th. But it's not me. So we're moving it back 1 month. And the primary reason is that we want to have the offerings, you know, that Harlan's put out. You guys have seen some of the things in the new car to make sure that vehicles that are in inventory that we can get through some of the 18 model year. It's also not so easy, which we're dealing with right now. Making a model year change, there's lots of new things. And so we wanted to make sure that the supply base and some of our other systems that will remain intact, you know, DVT, final line, there are some things that will stay that we could get through and learn some of those events before we shut down. But for sure, when we come back, there will be an insatiable demand for vehicles. Every dealer will be looking to have them, which again is a pressure that will come on the plant to perform.
So you're looking at a reduction of volume?
Yeah, so you might think I tried to avoid the question. and this is really good because it kind of takes one to know one. I didn't intentionally do that. The fact of the matter is that we see a reduction this year in the volume required. Since we have come back in January, you know, some people thought that, I don't know what people thought about we didn't start up right after the Christmas break as we know it. We didn't start up because we had projects going. That engine line was going in, and we completely redid the care line in our facility, which I didn't show you pictures of. We were doing projects. That's why we didn't come back. And then when we did come back, we came back with a plan to work 4 10-hours a day instead of 5 10-hours a day. And the reason we work 4 days instead of 5 days, because you work, you know, 40 hours a week, which is what works with the volume that we need. If you work 4 10-hours a day and you don't run the fifth day, we save a lot of money in energy costs associated with our paint shop. And we have logistics costs that we save on, et cetera, et cetera. So this year, we anticipate to have roughly 25,000 cars produced, and that's with the 13 weeks down. Next year, you know, honestly, it's not May yet. I don't know what the volumes will be. But, you know, if you would look back at the history of the car, you know, the fifth and sixth year, you know, the demand kind of goes down because people got the car and they're looking for something new. Next question, one right here. It's nicely.
With all of the new facilities what kind of a cost is that going to be to the consumer?
So the question is, you're doing all this stuff, what's the end cost increase for the consumer? Mm-hmm. And this is why I'm so glad Harlan came.
Harlan!
$45. another way to answer that, and again, not trying to avoid the question, I'm going to use paint job numbers because they're right at the top of my head. And there's a lot of assumptions that go into this, but I'm going to give you a rough idea. If you would take an investment like a paint shop and you would depreciate it in 10 years, which you wouldn't, it would be longer because they should last longer. I'm just going to use 10 years because it's divisible by 10, it's easier math for me. And since I'm doing the math, you have to listen. And in the first few years of the Corvette, we made 40,000 cars roughly a year, 40, 41, 39. So 40,000 a year, this really works on a $400 million investment with a 10-year amortization, that gets to be $1,000 a car. If it's 10 years, and if you have that volume. So this will give you the cost to the company. What that translates to the consumer will be $45, as Harlan said. The intent isn't to have a big uptick. You know, we've had a very successful vehicle. So, you know, you have to look at it as if we've been banking money, so to speak. Next question, John.
We're going from 17.2 to 12 per hour from 3 minutes to do my job to 5 minutes. Will down the road, as my muscle memory gets back and the quality control shows you and all GM, we're right where we want to be, will that ramp up above or reverse? Will I then get not my 5 minutes, but 4.5? Four and back toward three?
It's a good question and it's very insightful. The question is this. You said that you're going to go from 17 jobs an hour, which is our tack time, or jobs per hour, to roughly 12. And there's a decimal that's in there, but I'm making it simple. 17 to 12. The answer is we're locked into 12. And the reason is that we have an unbelievably synchronous operation. Our body shop is tuned in to 12 an hour. Our paint shop, which what I just showed you, if somebody called up, I call Chuck Valentini and I say, Chuck, crank her up to 17, we gotta get some cars out. No. Bake a cookie in 4 minutes. You can't do it. It's a completely different, it might be possible, it's a completely different problem. So the ability for us to vary volume based on demand will be the amount of hours that we work during the day. Right? So we've always been a one shift that could have to change. Buy the cars and we'll figure it out.
Very good. Okay.
How are we doing on time?
Yeah, 2 minutes.
2 minutes. One more question. Right here.
After the 13-week downtime, when are you going to start plant tours again?
Okay, so this is another. This is a. So we said we had 2 minutes left. 22 minutes, 20 seconds. So the question, I'll repeat it, is when are we going to reinstate plant tours? We're holding off right now on when we're going to announce the starting of the plant tours for a couple of reasons. Number one, as you've seen here today, we're completely changing everything. It is not right now the absolute priority for us to figure out how a tour would go through. I'm not getting choked up, might seem like it. On a very pragmatic approach, when we do all this work, everybody has to give us a chance to get up and running. It's always been a concern of mine. I so much love having people come through the plant. You maybe have heard we refer to this as a symbiotic relationship. We are better because the people come through the plant, and the people in the plant are, you know, we're better and you enjoy it. It really works good. Our employees so much like the fact fact that that they hear the appreciation for what they do, because it is tough work, you know, do some of the jobs that we have in the plant. They're truly not easy. So we need to have the focus when we come back to get the plant up, get it done safely, get it done with high quality, and then we'll reconsider. Now, if you were to ask me when that would be, we're probably going to be down a year, possibly more, because we have a lot of stuff going on. Right? Okay, I appreciate not one person asking me a future product question. And I appreciate your contribution to the afternoon. Thanks, everybody.